Yes.
Hello, good afternoon, everyone. So, we'd like to welcome Dr. Frederick Alexander. He is the head of the Mimozine team, INRIA project team of the INRIA Research Center, Bordeaux, Sadost, common with the CNRS UMR Library Laboratory in Computer Science, hosted by UMR IMN in the Bordeaux Neuro Campus. The goal of his team at the frontier between integrative and computational neuroscience is to model the brain as a system of active memories in synergy and in interaction with the world to simulate it as a whole and in situation. His team also gives special emphasis to decision making and associated pathologies and interested in large scale implementation and in robotics. Over to you, sir.
Hello, thank you for this kind introduction. So I'm going to share my screen. It's okay, I guess. Okay, my screen?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so as it was said in the introduction, at the same time we are modeler, so we are making models, and originally coming from artificial intelligence and machine learning, and on the other hand we are part of a neuroscience lab in Bordeaux, which means that we have strong interaction with people working on the brain, and also particularly for neurodegenerative disease, and consequently our work is to try to relate these two domains. So perhaps I will begin by a short introduction on the artificial intelligence and machine learning side. So I'm quite sure that you have all heard about deep networks, which are among the most famous model in artificial intelligence today. So basically here we have a scheme of a deep network. So these systems are used, for example, for image recognition. So you have a series of what we call convolutional layers, which are used to extract features, and after we are able to make a classification. For example, here the goal is to discriminate between animals or boat recognition, for example, and classically we use a descent gradient algorithm, like backpropagation algorithm, in order to train this model. And indeed, this model very recently had very impressive results on a variety of tasks. So these are for deep networks. Then there is another kind of model which are very interesting and very powerful today. These models are related to reinforcement learning. So here the goal is to help an agent decide for actions in a certain environment where the agent can receive from time to time, can receive a reward. And what I show here on the picture is an example of architecture for reinforcement learning, where we have, for example, here what we call a critic. So the goal of the critic is to learn to put a value on different states. And this is made thanks to an algorithm which is called the temporal difference algorithm, which is based on reward prediction error. So thanks to this algorithm, you are able to learn value, but you are also able to train another module of the model, which is called the actor. And the actor is the one which decides for action. And so this model, again, are very powerful and has provided very strong results. For example, for video games, if you have seen all the recent results about artificial intelligence agent playing video games, this is made with this kind of system. And now, Speaking about biological plausibility, what we can say, that there is a certain plausibility to a certain level and to a certain architectural level. For example, concerning deep networks, we can see here the architecture of the visual stream of the cortex, where you can see the primary visual area and then a series of hierarchical areas going toward the inferotemporal lobe. And in some sense, we can make a kind of parallel between this architecture with a hierarchy of layers and this architecture where from the retina to the regions which make recognition, we have also this kind of architecture, even if, of course, in the case of the brain, the system is probably much more complex. But generally, it is said that deep networks are in some sense inspired by biology because of this architecture. Okay, so it is the same for reinforcement learning, and here the parallel is made with loops that we can observe in the brain between the frontal cortex and a series of nuclei that we call the basal ganglia. And in fact, particularly, we can describe two loops, one loop which relate the motor and premotor cortex with a certain region of the basal ganglia, certain region of the striatum and of other nuclei of the basal ganglia. So this generally we associate this with the actor, because we know that in the brain this region allows to decide for policy of action. And then we can also observe other loops between the frontal cortex and here, more specifically between the medial prefrontal cortex and other regions of the basal ganglia. And we know that in this loop, we are also able to decide for goals in the brain and consequently to decide for the value of certain regions. And again, here we can draw a certain parallel between this loop and the critique of the reinforcement learning system. Okay, but now if we discuss a bit about the kind of function we are considering here, in fact, this function, we can describe them. This one is in fact for recognition, for identification. Here with deep network, you are able to discriminate objects, for example. With the critique, you are able to predict the value of state, and with the actor, you are able to decide for an action. So, of course, we can say that these are intelligent functions. But now, if we are thinking of human intelligence, perhaps we might say that identification, prediction, and decision making are not the apex, are not the maximum of our intelligence. And probably we might also think about reasoning, about deliberation, about we have other many functions, about problem solving. We have many other intelligent functions that we can perform. And the fact is that today, with artificial intelligence, we are rather oriented with these functions, which are relatively simple. Another point I would like to underline is the problem of time processing. What I have shown before are systems which give immediately an answer. So, of course, often a good answer, but which have some difficulties with dealing with tasks where you have sequences. And the fact, again, if you are thinking of intelligent function, most of the time you will see that time is very present. For example, I take the function, which is among the very intelligent functions that we are able to perform. And of course, in language, sequence processing is very critical. And this is not simple to be used with the classical deep learning system. So that's why there have been other models which have been proposed. For example, you have probably heard about LSTM, about the long short-term memories model. Here on this picture, I show another example that we are studying in the brain, which is the case of reservoir computing. So here the idea is that you have an input. So the global architecture is close to a perceptron, where you have an input, where you have here a hidden layer and here an output layer. But the fact is that in the hidden layer, you have in fact what you call a reservoir of hidden units, and between these units, you have recurrences, internal recurrences, which make in fact that this reservoir is able to store and to manipulate sequences. So I will not go in details about the functioning of this algorithm, but basically the idea is, as I show here in the case of language, for example, is that we are able, when we propose in as input a sequence of words, for example, then we are able to store and represent this sequence in terms of temporal sequence in the reservoir, and here in the output we are able to immediately associate the state, the current state of the sequence with some grammatical function of words, and consequently we are able with this system to identify some sequences and to be able, for example, to say which word is the subject, is where, which word is the verb, or something like this. And recently what we have also done is we have used the hierarchy of this system, and consequently we are able to deal with complete language and going through the detection of phonemes, words, sentences, and so on. So just to say, also in this case, we have some tools. So also in the case of sequence processing, we have also some tools in machine learning, which allows to manipulate this kind of problem and to perform a rather good performance for several tasks. But now the question is, if we try to be a little bit more critical about this function, and to discuss a little bit about their weaknesses, perhaps the first point to underline is to say that in fact what we learn here, if again if we draw a parallel with the brain, what we learn here is what we call implicit memory, which means that we are in fact learning very slowly some statistical properties of the data, and which means that to have an efficient learning, what we need is a big corpus. And generally this is one of the problems with deep learning. For example, it works, but you have to propose a very very large corpus of example. In addition, the corpus must be balanced, which means that you must have examples and many examples of all the different classes you would like to learn. Again, as I said before, this learning is very slow. And when I say very slow, it can be very, very slow. And another problem, again, if we compare with human abilities, is that what we learn is statistics, which means, for example, that it cannot take into account specific cases, but instead it learns statistics. So we know that in humans, of course, and in other animals, we are able to take into account specific cases, and we know that this is specifically possible because of the hippocampus, about this architecture of the medial temporal lobe, this architecture which allows to perform what we call episodic memory, and to particularly to learn by heart specific cases. What I have put here on the top right of my slide is an example of model which has been recently made to try to mimic the function of the hippocampus. purpose model is what we call neural Turing machine. And so the idea is, so here you have a classical deep learning system, but in addition, we add a memory, an explicit memory where you can store specific cases. And consequently, you have to decide if you learn with the statistics or if you store and if you explicitly keep in memory some examples here. And after, you can take your decision based either on the statistics or on the specific case that you have stored here. The problem, so this system is interesting, but it has several weaknesses, and particularly the weakness that, again, it has to learn with backpropagation, and again, this learning is very, very slow. Another problem is for the decision of which example we have to keep in memory. So, first type of weaknesses, how to deal with a specific case. Another kind of weaknesses is about flexibility. We know, for example, probably you have heard about a task we can do with redundant experiment. The task is reversal. So, for example, you learn to the rat that if he press on the left lever, he will get a reward. And after, it has to learn that if he press on the right lever, it will get the reward. And consequently, you are going to change the rule, and possibly after you can come back to the first rule. And the question of the flexibility is in fact the time it takes to switch from one rule to the other rule. And of course, we know that in animals, in humans, we are very flexible, which means that we are able, when we see that the previous rule is no longer working, we will not insist anymore. And we will try to use another rule. And what is also interesting is that we are able to learn in context, and consequently, instead of forgetting the old rule, we are able to have a series of rules, and then depending on the context, to say, okay, in this context, I have to choose rule one or rule two or rule three. And so in this case, we are very flexible. Of course, this is not possible with deep learning or with a reinforcement learning system where you learn only one rule. And if the rule changes, you have to unlearn and to learn the new rule. So in animals, so in the brain, we know that this possibility of flexibility is particularly due to the prefrontal cortex, to the anterior part of the frontal cortex, which inside the medial PFC, prefrontal cortex, and on the lateral side also the lateral PFC. And again, the idea here of models which have been proposed accordingly is again to use a classical deep learning system, but also to add a memory where in fact we can, and here we call this a working memory, and we are able to keep in memory the fact that we are in a certain context, and consequently to associate this context to the choice of a certain rule. And this is what we call also meta learning. And so the idea is to discuss about learning to learn. Here, what we learn is to choose rules. So first we learn rules, and after, at a second level of abstraction, what we learn in fact is how to choose rules depending on the context. So this is the task of the prefrontal cortex. Alors, as I have shown here, there are presently some models which have been proposed, but again, these models are based on backpropagation learning algorithm, and consequently are very slow, and consequently what we are presently considering is the possibility to develop more bio-inspired model, to have something which is more comparable, which have similar properties as what we can find in humans. So I go quickly on this model. So first, concerning the hippocampus. So here, I just draw a parallel between the characteristics of the hippocampus and the characteristics of the cortex. So as I said before, mainly cortex is for slow learning, whereas hippocampus is to learn very quickly. And particularly, so here I show a picture with a scheme of the main region of the hippocampus, and particularly we have this region here, which is called dentate gyrus, and which is characterized by a very sparse representation. And in fact, what we learn in the dentate gyrus is when you have a novel pattern, we are able to learn only what is novel in this pattern, and consequently, thanks to this encoding, this kind of orthogonal encoding, you are able to learn very rapidly and without interference from one memory to the other. So in the dentate, so we have algorithms that we develop for the implementation of orthogonal and consequently very rapid to learn representation in the dentate gyrus. Then we learn in CA3 here. What we learn here is the sequence of patterns that we can find in a episode, and consequently we are able with the dentate gyrus and CA3 to learn episode. And then the goal is to be able to reproduce, to send back to the cortex this episode. And this is one characteristic which is important, which is called the replay. So it is the fact that the hippocampus not only is able to store specific episode, but is also able to send back and to replay this episode to the cortex. And this is important because, as I said before, the cortex with its statistical learning needs a balanced corpus, and consequently, thanks to this replay, we are able to balance corpus and to send more examples which are more important for learning, for example. And to do so, this is the role of another region, which is CA1, and the role of CA1 is in fact to be a kind of translator between what has been learned episodic in CA3 and what is stored statistic in the cortex, and consequently we are able to learn directly in CA1 to learn this correspondence between what is learned in CA3 and so which is one shot and what is learned which is statistics in the cortex. And again, here we are also working on this kind of algorithm to learn this association, which makes that at the end we are able to learn very quickly in one shot examples in the CS3, and then to exploit this for the replay in the cortex. Okay, coming now to the prefrontal cortex, as I said before, so the goal is to detect when the classical rule does not work and when you have to use a contextual rule. And to do so, what you have to do with the PFC, with the prefrontal cortex, is in fact to predict outcome, and when you have an outcome which is different from what was predicted, then in a part of the PFC, which is the medial PFC, you are able to monitor this error, and depending on this error, to inhibit, first to inhibit the dominant behavior, and second to learn contextual rule and to promote them, to use them instead directly. And this is done particularly with another, if you remember before, I have shown two different loops associating the frontal cortex with the basal ganglia, so with the motor region and with the medial region. But in fact, there is a third kind of loop, which is with the lateral region. And in fact, in this region, so the region of the lateral PFC, it is the place where we are able to store specific contextual rules, and consequently when in the medial PFC we are able to see that there is an error and that we have to take an adapted behavior, so first we inhibit it, and then the lateral PFC can use and promote the contextual rule, so, and use immediately the contextual rule it has stored, and thanks to this we can have this property of flexibility. to use this, consequently, we must implement this property, this mechanism of working memory. So here I show a series of models which has been proposed with LSTM, for example. We are able to implement working memories. There are other models which have been proposed, and there is particularly one that we also develop in the team that I show here, which is able to implement working memory with this model of reservoir that I have presented before. And again, at the end, the point is we are able to propose a more biologically plausible model of working memory, and particularly which are able to act very flexibly, very quickly. And this in contrast with models that exist today, for example, with LSTM, where the learning is still very slow. So you are able to have a series of behavior, but you are not able to flexibly switch rapidly from one to the other, and which is one essential property of human cognition and animal cognition also. Okay, so if I have to summarize what I have said before about hippocampus and PFC. So in short, hippocampus, the idea of hippocampus is that it is able to make a rapid binding of arbitrary association, and particularly that it is able to store very quickly episode Dendrite gyrus and CA3, and this is in contrast with cortex, where here you learn the statistical association, and consequently you can have both. You can have a statistical association and you can have a specific example in the hippocampus. And now, as for PFC, what we can do with PFC is to bias the normal behavior of your system, and we are able to inhibit the dominant behavior and instead to promote contextual behavior flexibly. And again, if we don't have this, we have what we call perseveration, which means that we are going to continue and insist on a specific behavior which is no longer adapted. For example, with one student, with Snigdha Daggar, we have implemented a model to replicate an experiment which was made by a neuroscientist in our lab. It is with a radial maze for rodent. And so first, what we learn these two arms A of the radial maze. First, we learn what we call alternation task. So the rat has to learn that he has to go in one arm to get a reward. After, he has to go in another arm to have a reward. And then he has to alternate. If the rat want to get reward, he has to learn to alternate from one arm to the other to get a reward. And consequently, you have to implement a working memory to remember where you are and to remember which arm you have to do. But after the rat, we can also learn this with three pairs of arms, which makes that at a certain time, the rat has to keep in memory for any pair of arms what was the present alternation he has to implement. And to do this, the rat has also to implement an episodic memory to remember the last episode where he was, for example, in the pair of arms C to learn the good alternation. So we have been able to success to replicate this task. And now, just to conclude about this, something I would like to add also, which is in my mind very important, is so I have shown the properties, very interesting and powerful properties of hippocampus and PFC, but what is also very important to understand is the properties of both systems together. And basically, what we have when we have both systems interacting together is the possibility to make what we call prospective memory and to make planning. Prospective memory is the memory of the future, is to be able to imagine what could happen if we can do this and do so and so on. And basically, the idea is that the PFC, which is able to inhibit and to bias representation of perception is also to do the same with hippocampus. So to do the same biasing, but not with perception, but with episode in the hippocampus. And in fact, if you put this together, so if you implement this loop between PFC and hippocampus, what we get is prospective memory and imagination. So we are able to block or to trigger specific episodic memories. And thanks to this, you are able to imagine what could happen in certain cases. Okay, so to conclude on how we can model higher cognitive function, as I said, today AI is still mainly based on a slow statistical learning, which is not what we observe with the flexibility of human and the fact that we are able to learn very rapidly. So I have explained that if we develop bio-inspired model of the hippocampus and PFC, we can get such properties. And what now we are targeting, so referring to the idea of prospective memory, is to try to implement more complex higher cognitive function like problem solving, reasoning, metacognition, creativity, or this kind of task. And just 2 points, perhaps today, which are a little bit weak, is the fact that probably we could have something more powerful by taking a better implementation of interoception, for example, to take into account motivation and of embodiment. And these two properties are very important and are probably not taken into account well in what I have shown here. Okay, so thank you very much for your attention.